Good morning to all of you. Today's topic is the role of GIS in emergency response and management. The GIS is very much helpful in emergency response system and management of disasters. In case of disaster or in case of any natural hazard, GIS, remote sensing technology, is very much useful for managing and for the mitigation strategies, especially in case of natural disasters. So today we will see how GIS is helpful in emergency response and management system. So first I would like to start with the contents in today's lecture. Okay, today we will first discuss the definition, the different definitions in emergency response, then what are the role of GIS in emergency response, the keywords in emergency management. We will discuss some case studies, how this GIS is helpful in managing the natural disasters or the emergency response management system, and result and the conclusion. Okay, so before starting, first I would like to start with the definition of emergency management. Okay, when we talk about emergency management, emergency means it's not a fixed problem, it's a sudden kind of problem. Okay, so the emergency management can be defined as the discipline and the profession of applying science, technology, planning and management to deal with the extreme events that can injure or kill large number of people and do extensive damage to the property and disrupt the community life. Okay, its name is emergency, means these are some sudden natural disasters, these are some sudden you can say hazards that occurred. So we need to have an integrated approach, we need to have multiple disciplines to deal with such kind of emergencies. Like, we can have science, technology, planning, management activities. We need to apply an integrated approach of different science. It may require earth science, it may require some mathematical sciences, physics, chemistry. We should have different technology, planning and management activities to deal with the extreme events. Okay, these extreme events, or you call it as a disaster or hazard, it can kill large number of people. So we need to have proper management so that we can save the life of the people and we can save the property. Although the saving the property is not our prime objective. Our prime objective is not saving the property. Our main motive is to save the life of the humans. Okay, so we should focus on developing such emergency management system that can be helpful to save the life of the peoples living in that area where they are facing some kind of disasters or hazards. Okay, so emergency management is a discipline, you can say it's a multidisciplinary approach. It requires multiple disciplines to save the lives of the human life in case of any kind of disasters and hazard. Okay, so what is the need of these emergency response? Emergency response is a quick action what we take during hazard or disaster. It's a quick response. Okay, so the preparing, the role of emergency response, or the importance of emergency response, is in preparing the communities to respond to the bioterrorist threats or event in a top priority in our country right now. With GIS as a core component to this solution, the immediate impact will be make use GIS an integral component of day-to-day operations of public health and public safety organizations. Okay, in case of any emergency response, in case of any emergency, like in case of a terror attack, in case of some natural disasters, in case of some hazards, we need to have some integrated approach. We need to prepare the communities, we need to prepare the population in that area so that they can respond very quickly and they can evacuate the place to go at the safe places. So GIS is providing us an integral component. It is providing us the solution to day-to-day operations of public health and public safety organizations. Okay, so emergency response includes the communities also. We should include the communities. It is not only the responsibility of the government, but also the responsibility of the communities, responsibility of the public, so that they will be ready to respond in case of any emergency. and GIS is now helping in such kind of emergency response activities, emergency response management. Okay, so the effective and realistic emergency management program, it depends on various data sources. Okay, if we talk about natural disaster, if we talk about any natural hazard, so we need to have the data sets from various sources, and we need to analyze and display that data set so it can be used as a solution to a problem. Okay, so emergency management is a it is a desirable to have the right data. So we need to have a proper data sets so that we can have this as an organized manner in a usable format for the stakeholders to respond and take action in case of any emergency. Although we are having multiple data sets, we are having different data sources, we are having different softwares, we are having different tools, but we need to choose the proper data set. We need to choose the appropriate data places at the appropriate place at the right time, so that these kind of data sets should be organized in a usable format for stakeholders to respond and take the action in case of any emergency. So most of the emergency data requirements are of spatial nature. Okay, when there is a natural disaster, so whatever the data you are collecting, whatever the data, or you can say whatever the satellite images you are retrieving, whatever the secondary data sets, socioeconomic data sets, or any kind of meteorological data sets you are having, all the data sets are a type of spatial data sets. So if you are dealing with spatial data sets, definitely you need to have geographical information system, because spatial data sets can only be deal with geographic information system, GIS system. Okay, so GIS is now becoming very prominent tool in emergency response management and emergency response in case of any kind of natural disaster, in any cause of hazard, or in any kind of man-made events like terror attack or any other activities. Okay, so GIS, as we know that GIS technology gives public safety to the personnel to manage and analyze the large amount of data sets. Okay, GIS can deal with the large amount of data sets, and these data sets include the file from the legacy system that can be stored in the geo database, and it will be used to visualize the spatial relationship and reveal the trends that is critical to the public safety response and the planning. So GIS is a computer-based system. It will helpful to generate the maps in the digital format that can be shared across a network, that can be shared across the world through the internet, that we call it as a web GIS. Okay, whatever the maps you have prepared related to any disaster or hazard, these maps can be shared across the network using web GIS with multiple agencies to coordinate the effort and the maximizing the resources. Okay, if your map is published on the website, so different agencies or different organizations working in the field of disaster management and mitigation, they can have the coordination, they can combinedly work, they can effectively work together to maximize the use of resources and to prevent, to mitigate the effects of any emergency like natural disasters or hazards. Okay, so the basic advantage of GIS is to visualize the spatial data sets. We can visualize, we can prepare the maps of the spatial data sets, and these maps can be shared across the world through internet, that we call it as web GIS. So this is the importance of geographical information system or geographical information science in case of emergency management system. Okay, so you see here GIS is very much useful in dealing the disasters, any kind of hazards, any kind of emergency, because of its interoperability. Means a same data sets can be used by multiple organizations, a same data sets can be used by different agencies who are working in disaster management and planning. So now moving to the next slide. So these are the application areas where GIS can be used. GIS can be used in different areas related to the emergency response. It can be used in environmental modeling, GIS can be used in utility services, utility mapping. GIS can also be used in transportation, in natural resource management, which I have already discussed yesterday. What is the role of GIS in natural resource management? GIS can also be used in population and socioeconomic studies, socioeconomic modeling. Okay, and there are other related technical issues, geographical data modeling, accuracy and uncertainty. But when we deal with the spatial data sets using GIS, so there is also a possibility of having some uncertainty, some inaccuracies. Okay, so we need to deal with the uncertainties and inaccuracies that can be found in the application of GIS. Okay, so here in the left hand side, these are the applications of GIS in case of emergency management. And in the right side, you can see the technical issues that we can face during the use of GIS in emergency management. We can have some accuracy issues. We can sometimes, we need to develop a spatial decision support system, spatial data integration. Sometimes you need to integrate multiple data sets into the single platform. Okay, so there may be some problems related to the integration. Real-time GIS is very much useful for management of the emergency. Three-dimensional GIS and GPS. Okay, so applications are there. GIS can be used in various applications, and there are other technical issues are there. So we can overcome the technical issues by applying appropriate tools and techniques, by applying some useful softwares. So GIS can be used in emergency management system, and it is dependent on the organizational structure and the legal issues. If the organization is well equipped with the software, if any organization is well equipped with the data sets, they are having skilled manpower, so they can easily use GIS for various applications in case of emergency management. Okay, so moving to the next slide. So the role of GIS in managing the sudden impacts. Sudden impacts means these are some emergencies. It may be like flood, it may be forest fire. Okay, these are some kind of sudden occurred response emergencies. Rather than one slow onset hazards like radon gas, water pollution, land erosion, or other natural or technological hazards that occur gradually over the time. So GIS is very much useful in managing the suddenly occurred event. You can call it as an emergency. It may be flood, it may be forest fire, it may be earthquake. Okay, it may be any cyclone, and it may be any kind of other natural disasters. And all these things can be managed very well using GIS and remote sensing technology. Okay, so these are some important terms that you need to remember. Emergency, what is emergency? The emergency is a course of event that enters the people, property, and the environment, or a deviation from the planned or expected behavior. Hazard refers to the physical characteristics that may cause an emergency. Hazard may be natural hazard or man-made hazard. Risk may be defined as a potential or the likelihood that an emergency might occur. Disasters is an emergency that cannot be managed by the local resources. And assessment is the analysis of the situation or event. So these are important definitions of different terms. Emergency, what is emergency, what is hazard, what is risk, what is disaster. So there is a difference between hazard and disaster. Okay, hazard is referred as a physical characteristic that may cause an emergency. It may cause an emergency, it may not. Sometimes it may cause emergency, sometimes it may not cause emergency. But disaster is an emergency that cannot be managed by the local resources. It's a kind of emergency that cannot be managed by the local resources, local authorities. So we need to have some skilled persons, we need to have trained persons to deal with the disaster. So emergency, hazard, risk, disaster, assessment, these are some important definitions, important terms that is used in emergency response planning and management. Okay, disasters may be of two types: natural disasters and man-made disasters or anthropogenic disasters. Natural disasters are the results from natural processes like earthquake, drought, flooding, landslide, volcanic activities, cyclones, hurricanes, typhoon, and other kind of torrential rains or heavy rainfall. These are the natural disasters. But although there are certain human-induced disasters, or you can say the man-made disasters are there. These man-made disasters are resulted from the human activities. Like you can call it as a fire, then epidemics, crashes, some explosion, accidents, some internal disturbances like riots, rebel activities, violent strikes, displacement, and the evictions. So disasters may be categorized into natural and man-made. Some disasters are cross-cutting both natural and human-induced. In some cases, the disasters can be considered as natural and the man-made. Okay. So this is the role of GIS in disaster risk assessment. The disaster management starts with, first you need to locate and identify the problem. You need to locate the location where disaster is occurred, and you need to identify the potential emergency problems and how they are going to relate the existing environment. Okay, before starting any management activities, you need to locate the location of the disaster, and then you need to identify the possible emergency problems. Then you need to check what facilities are available in that area, the location of the mitigation facilities such as fire station, potential refugee and camp, spread of the spills and location of medical facilities, extent of the damage and the infection, water resources, and any humanitarian intervention. Okay, then after identifying the location of the disaster and after knowing the existing facilities in that area, we can use now GIS that will provide a mechanism that will be helpful to developing a mechanism to integrate multiple data sets from a variety of sources to analyze this disaster, and it will be presented to the planners and decision makers in real time so that they can use this data set in disaster management and mitigation. Okay, so this is the role of GIS. You need to first identify the location, then you need to identify the existing facilities, whether there is a hospital is there, fire station is there, how many hospitals are there, what is the capacity of the hospitals. All this information will be helpful in disaster risk assessment and mitigation planning. Then all these data sets can be integrated using GIS platform, and this will be analyzed, and the results will be shared with the planners and decision makers so that they can use this data set for making decision and proper management of the disasters. Okay, so these are the following disasters that have been used in the risk zoning criteria: man-made and natural. When we talk about man-made zoning, it may have some banditry, refugees, neighborhood tension, tribal conflict. Natural zoning includes the drought, earthquake, flooding, landslide, volcanic activities. Okay, so these are two different kinds of disasters, man-made and naturals. In case of man-made disasters, you need to define a zone. That zone will be based on some boundary. And in case of natural disasters, suppose in case of drought, so you can also define the boundary, that how much area is affected by the drought, how much area is affected by the earthquake and flooding, landslide. All these things can be done by the disaster risk zoning. After the disaster occurred, after the occurring of disaster, we need to define some zone, risk zone. The risk zone is the zone where there is a highly probability of the damage to the human life and the property. Okay, so we need to define the risk zone. Okay, these are some man-made disasters: banditry, refugees, neighborhood tension, tribal conflict. Okay, so I'm not going in detail about all these man-made disasters, and these are common disasters like tribal conflict. If in forest, if you are constructing some roads and some buildings, so there may be the tribal conflict. Neighborhood tension will be there between two countries. There will be neighborhood tension. Then refugee is a kind of problem. It may be considered as the man-made disasters. Banditry means it's kind of you can say the areas that is affected by the rebel activities. The some group of the people who are against the government, they want having some internal war in that country. So these are the man-made disasters. Natural disasters are already known to you. You are very well aware with natural disasters: drought, earthquake, then flooding, landslide, volcanic activities. Out of all the natural disasters, right now we are having flooding and landslide problems because of the heavy rainfall. Flooding are the areas within the neighborhood of the water bodies such as lakes and river. In recent time, you heard the news that most of the part in India is facing heavy rainfall. Because of this heavy rainfall, all the rivers are having increased water level, so that may cause the flooding. So there are at the risk of flooding in case of any disturbance in the hydrology of such water bodies, depending on the magnitude of the disturbance. It is assumed that the effect of flooding could affect area within 2 kilometers from the water body. So if there is a river, so both side of the river up to 2 kilometers, there may be the effect of the flooding in case of heavy rainfall. Earthquake are the areas that are affected by the Western Rift Valley, and those that have experienced incidents of the earthquake, drought, landslides. Because of the heavy rainfall, there may be the problem of landslide. There are steep slopes, steep hilly slopes that may collapse during the heavy rainfall, volcanic activities. So these are some natural disasters. You are very well aware with all these things. This is the emergency response management. The emergency response management is a cyclic process. It includes mitigation, then response, recovery. Mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery. In case of any disaster or in the emergency response management, we need to start with these 4 factors: mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery. These 4 factors are very important in case of emergency response. Okay, so what is mitigation? First, we will see what is mitigation. Mitigation involves the actions, some activities that are taken to eliminate or reduce the degree of long-term risk to the human life and property from the hazard. Preparedness is concerned with the actions that are taken in the advance of the emergency. If you know that if you are having prior information, that like in case of cyclone, okay, the information will be circulated before 2 or 3 days prior to the cyclone. So during that period, you can take some actions in advance to develop some operational capabilities and facilities of effective response to the emergency. So we can evacuate the persons living in the coastal region. So this is the preparedness. If you are having prior information, if you already know that what kind of problem is going to occur in within 2-3 days, if there in case of cyclone, so government already circulate the information, meteorological department already provide you the information that after 2-3 days the cyclone will hit some coastal region. So you can work for the preparedness. Preparedness means you can have the prior information, so you can develop, you can have some emergency response, and you can evacuate the person living in that area. Mitigation involves the actions that may be taken to eliminate or reduce the degree of effect, degree of risk to the human life. If you know that cyclone is going to hit the coastal region, so you can take some actions, you can take some you can prepare some mitigation planning to reduce the degree of risk to the human life. A response involves the action that are taken immediately before, during, or after the emergency. Okay, what kind of actions are taken by the government? What kind of actions are taken by the authorities before the emergency or before the disaster, after the disaster, or during the disaster, that will be helpful to save the life and minimize the damage to the property? Recovery phase is characterized by the activity to return the life to the normal or the improved levels. Okay, so these are some these are 4 terms: mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery. In case of emergency response management, these 4 activities are important. Based on these 4 activities, you can have proper response management system. GIS based resource management for the natural hazard mitigation. So this is a case study in which GIS is used for resource management in case of natural disaster. A prototype implementation has been developed for the Chennai city. Okay, so this study was done for Chennai and that was based on the GIS. This methodology, this work involves the location of emergency management facilities such as temporary shelters, medical relief center, telecommunication facilities, food storage and distribution centers. The resources are required for managing the disasters such as food, medical supplies and the vehicles. So there are vital time is lost in identifying the nearest facility, and the best route is to approach that area at which very often means the difference between the success and failure of a rescue and the rehabilitation operation. For that, the network data model can be used. A network is a system of interconnected linear features. It may be considered as the road network. Okay. So this model consists of network links, network nodes, stops, centers, and turns. It will be characterized by a network model or supply and demand impedance. The network data model elements are links, turns, stops, centers, and the barriers. So supply and demand means, for an example, if a hospital has a specific number of beds available, this is the term as supply. And streets are designed to hospital until the total demand for these beds matches the supply. So before the emergency, you should have prior information about the number of hospitals, how many number of beds are available in that hospital. And after that, we need to define the specific route. We need to define a specific network through which a person can reach to the hospital. Okay, that can be done using network analysis, network modeling. Impedance is the cost that is associated with the utilization of the supplied resources through a network analysis. So network analysis can be done using GIS, and the distance and time are commonly used as an impedance to the utility of the supply. If you don't know the shortest route to reach that hospital, so you can have more time to reach there. So GIS helps us to provide you the shortest route between the location of the emergency and to the hospital. And that can be done using network analysis. Okay, or you can call it a shortest path analysis. For that, GIS uses the road network of that area and calculate the number of vehicles moving in that area, or what is the traffic condition in that area. And then it will provide you the nearest shortest path so that you can reach the hospital in a quick time. So that can be very much important for saving the life of the person who are in the emergency. Okay. So this is the supply and demand option, the elements of network data model. So these are the links. Links are the represented as are the features that are connected to each other. That is node. So these are considered as the road network. Okay. So these road networks are the kind of vector data sets, and the links are considered as the two stops, two locations in that road that are connected with each other. The connections between the links are represented using the arc node. Arc node, it's a common term in GIS. Arc node means when you digitize a linear feature. So when you click a position, when you click on a location on your road, that will consider as that node. So the connections between the links are represented using the arc node topological data structure. An arc represents the transportation link. The line joining two nodes, are considered as the arc. And the individual point locations are considered as the node. Okay, so the transportation link are considered as the arc, and the attributes affect the movement of the resource through the network. In turns are the possible directions changes for the resource, that is flow very node, every link connected. Flow can occur from one link through the node and onto other link. Particular turns often restrict flow in the network. So this is the elements of network data model. Network data model is totally based on the GIS. GIS helps us to calculate the shortest path. GIS helps us to perform the network analysis. So it will provide you the shortest path to reach the hospital in case of emergency. Okay. These are some stops, centers, and barriers. And prototype model. So this is the prototype model. This is the Bay Area of Chennai between the two different locations that has been selected for the purpose of demonstration. And this implementation is for cyclone disaster management, but it can be easily extended for other disasters as well. The Bay Area was chosen as it is the closest representation of the coastal zone within the Chennai city. this is the study area where this kind of study is conducted. Okay, this is the formula which is used for calculating the distance between the two nodes. Okay, then the areas to be served by each hospital have been clearly identified. So it can also be notified that some intermediate areas have not been allocated to either of the hospital. So here you see, this is the road network of that area, and the areas which is covered by the general hospital, the area which is served by the Rohit-Pita hospital, and the area which is served by the proposed emergency facility. So depending on the location of the emergency facility, suppose at some place A there is an emergency and hospital is away from that location, so you need to check the nearest hospital to that emergency location, so you can easily reach within time, so it can save the life of human, it can save the life of the person who are in the danger, whose life is in the danger in case of any emergency. Okay, the calculation of the shortest route for the test location. So this is the way in which you can have the shortest path. Shortest route can be calculated on the basis of geographical information system. GIS helps us to provide the shortest route between the location of emergency and the nearest hospital. So you can reach there quickly within time. Okay, so this is the way in which GIS is helpful for emergency response management, emergency system. Okay, so as a concluding remark, we can see here GIS is an appropriate environment for developing a decision support system for resource management in case of natural disaster, natural hazard mitigation. The network module in ArcInfo, ArcGIS, is very much useful, very suited for addressing this issue. And the primary challenges in developing an effective decision support system lies in assessing the need of the decision makers and accurately the acquiring, representing, and updating the relevant data set in the GIS. GIS is very much useful because of its capacity, because of its ability to effectively deal with spatial data sets. You can integrate multiple data sets, you can integrate multiple raster data sets, vector data sets into a single platform, and you can apply any mathematical model, you can apply any kind of statistical analysis to perform, to solve any real world problem in case of emergency response, in case of emergency management. Okay, so this is all about the role of GIS in emergency response and management. And also GPS, that is global positioning system, is can also be helpful in using GIS for emergency management. GPS or global navigation system provides you the exact location of the emergency site, exact location of the location where natural disaster occurred or where there is a any kind of hazard. So it is very much useful to integrate the navigation data sets with the GIS. And also in some cases we need to apply, we need to use satellite images along with GIS to provide you the solution in case of emergency, in case of any natural disaster or hazards. So thank you very much for today's class, and we will meet again in the next lecture, that is the role of space technology, the role of different Earth observation technologies in disaster management and mitigation. Okay, today we have discussed some applications of GIS. Now we will see what are the applications of Earth observation data sets in emergency management and response system. So thank you very much for today's class.